Got it.
Right. Okay. Hi, John.
Got
All
it. Yeah,
right.
you've got
We
it.
what's that?
We got it.
Got
We got it.
it.
Three different.
There we go.
I feel like I'm juggling. Okay. All right. I'm gonna pin this one so that way it the computer is looking at that.
Most people with multiple screens put them all in front of themselves.
I know. Okay. Louise, here comes Louise too. Okay, good. All right. I think we're ready to go. So, all right, everybody at home, thank you for joining us. We have John here, and we are going to be talking about self-publishing, and I can pull things up onto the screen as we need to. So,
Okay.
all good. Yeah. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Hello, my name is John, and I'm an alcoholic. Oh, that's the wrong meeting. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. They meet on Wednesdays. I got mixed up there. Before I get into self-publishing, I'm going to talk a little bit about my writing process. Before intelligence was artificial, there was a media giant called Amazon. There's a reason that Jeff Bezos is the richest man in the world, worth $200 billion,
Wow.
billion with a B. Just how big is Amazon in the book-selling business? Almost 60% of all print books sold in the United States are sold by Amazon.
Really?
Net sales from books are over $25 billion a year. This includes over 1 million self-published books. So you may have a book on the shelf of Barnes and Noble, but Amazon reaches far more people. If you're familiar with my work, you know that I enjoy writing dialogue, and I've passed out a handout. He said, she said, are dialogue tags. But how many times can you say he said, she said until it becomes really, really boring? So I found this list to be very helpful, and it's broken into categories. For instance, if you want to signify tone, you can say quipped, retarded, snapped, jeered. If you want to show speed or rhythm, you can say stammered, stuttered, drawled. If you want to indicate action, you can say gasped, wheezed, choked, yawned. So I use this all the time, and I think it's really a big help in writing dialogues.
Tom said swiftly.
I'm going to talk a little bit about my writing process. Ernest Hemingway said, writing is easy. All you have to do is sit at a typewriter and bleed. Verlin Klinkenborg, it's a strange name, but I love the quote, said this, one by one, each sentence takes the stage. It says the very thing it came into existence to say, then it leaves the stage. It doesn't help the next one up or the previous one down. It doesn't wave to its friends in the audience or pause to be acknowledged or applauded. It doesn't talk about what it's saying. It simply says its piece and leaves the stage. There are at least four writing methods that novelists use to create the first draft of their stories. There's a seat of the pants. This is when you just write straight through without planning or editing. Then there's the edit as you go, which means you write without planning, but you edit thoroughly as you go. Snowflake. You make a general plan and write, changing the plan along the way. And then there's the outline, where you make a detailed plan before you write anything and you adhere to it strictly. I use the seat of the pants method. I find it exhilarating. The twists and turns in the plot surprise me as much as I hope they'll surprise the reader. One common way to construct a story is to follow the three-act structure of novel writing. Act one takes up roughly the first quarter and ends with a major disaster. Act two takes up the second and third quarters, and each quarter ends with an even worse disaster. And finally, act three takes up the last quarter and includes a climax, also called a resolution, which answers the question of whether your lead character will succeed. Do you have to follow the three-act structure? No, of course not. There are no unbreakable rules in fiction. My first novel, Violet Crown Sports Bar and Grill, took over 5 years to write. Why was this? Well, I was busy doing other things, did not give it the priority required for such an undertaking. I now assign my writing the priority it deserves. When I have a novel underway, I write for 2 to 4 hours a day, 2 hours in the morning, 2 more in the afternoon. I do this for 4 to 6 days a week. I do not outline my book. I start at the beginning and I write straight through to the end. Now, sometimes I'll change the order of the chapters if it helps the flow of the story. When I'm about halfway through, I know exactly how the book will end. And I sometimes will stop and write the final chapter so I will know in great detail where the story is going. After I complete a chapter, I do a chapter summary. This is a list of everything that took place in that chapter in bullet style. I find this to be very useful. If I'm writing on chapter 20 and I need to remember what conversation took place early on, I can find it more easily in the chapter summary instead of having to read through the whole book to try to find it. I also keep a list of plot twists. This is just a list of things I want to happen at some point in the story. The list is in no particular order, and I add to it whenever I think of something. So if I want there to be a plane crash or an explosion, I simply write that down. And when I start a chapter, I look over that list to see if it'll fit in, you know, that chapter. I find it very helpful. Now, once I decide to finish the book, first one, Violet Crown, I completed it in 314 pages. It's the longest book I have written. I then sent out 15 or 20 query letters to literary agents, and I received 15 or 20 rejections. I then decided it was time for me to self-publish the book. It was about this time that I discovered the West End Writers Group at Westlake Library. Joining the group has been a godsend. It has allowed me to become a better writer and to make new friends with like-minded people. My second book, Double Space, is, I think, the best novel. I think the story is unique, interesting, but at one point, I got so caught up with the paranormal aspects of the story that I could not follow it myself. I went back and simplified the narrative, eliminating several minor characters who did not contribute that much to the story. My third book, Pitch Man, required some research. I had to know the history of the circus, as well as the history of the United States in the year 1842. When you write a period piece, you need to get it right. My fourth book, A Murder of Crows, also required some research. I had to read up on crows because they are one of the main characters in the story. It is also very important that you back up your work. I subscribe to a service that backs up my computer. I also keep copies of all my novels on a thumb drive and update it every time I make any changes. My first attempt at self-publishing on Amazon Books using KDP was an adventure, to say the least. When I'm trying to learn something technical, I like to have written instructions to follow. So I looked at printing out the instructions for using KDP, and there was no way I could afford the ink or the paper it would take to do that. The next best thing is to buy a how-to book. I didn't even think of this for the first two or three books for some reason. It never occurred to me that there'd be books out there, but there are a lot of them.
What is it called? Will you hold it up one more time to the thing?
Okay, this is How to Self-Publish on Amazon by C. Graham Cann.
Thank you.
But frankly, I don't think you're going to need it after you hear this presentation.
All right.
Because I boiled it all down to about four pages.
Nice. That's what we need.
Okay. I mentioned that my first attempt at self-publishing on Amazon was quite an adventure. Anyway, I didn't realize you could buy a book. So the first couple of novels I wrote, I just jumped right in and learned it all on my own. Now, KDP can be overly complicated for a first-time user. I made so many mistakes that my first novel, Violet Crown, was filled with formatting problems. At the time, I did not know how to go back and correct all those problems after the book had been published. What I ended up doing was to correct all the problems in a second edition. And I still cringe to think that someone out there will buy the first edition with all of its mistakes.
Can you take the first edition down?
I haven't been able to take it down, no. After publishing four novels and a collection of essays, I am now more familiar with KDP and all its ins and outs.
Do you guys all know what KDP stands for?
Kindle Direct Publishing. Okay, before you self-publish your book, make sure that your manuscript is in the correct format.
Should I share my screen for this part?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. In formatting your document, select a pleasing font, such as Helvetica or Times New Roman. Select a font size of 12. 1-inch margins on all sides is standard. Use a line spacing of 1 or 1.5. Justify both the left and right margins. Indent each paragraph. Check the spelling and grammar for the entire manuscript and number the pages. I create my original manuscript using Microsoft Word. Before you begin the process of self-publishing your book, you will need to convert the manuscript to a PDF document. It's also a good idea to select a trim size for your book. All my books are 9 by 12 inches, they're 6 by 9 inches, 6 by 9.
So the size of the book.
Yeah, 6 by 9. Now, when you do this, this is a good time to review your manuscript because glitches can easily happen whenever you convert from a Word document to a PDF document. And whenever you change from a standard size of 8.5 by 11 to 6 by 9. So you need to review after you do this. For example, I don't like to start a chapter in the middle of the page.
Yeah.
That frequently happens. Now keep in mind, you can publish your book for free as an Amazon ebook, a paperback, a hardback, or an audiobook. Now, keep in mind that you will have to do all of this for each one. If you're going to do an ebook, you'll have to fill that out. You're going to do a paperback, you have to fill it all out again. A hardback, you have to fill it out a third time. On my first two books, I did the ebook, the paperback, and the hardback. After that, I only do the paperback because that's really, you know, all I want. So I don't have to do it three times.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Why is the formatting for a paperback different for a hardback? Why are those different sizes different?
It's not different. Mm-hmm. You just have to fill it out again.
Oh.
You know, I've found no way to take what you've done on the ebook and just transfer it to the paperback and then transfer it again to the hardback.
Mm-hmm.
You got to do it three different times. And particularly if you use the cover design in KDP, there's hardly no way you can recreate the cover exactly the same three different times. It's just virtually impossible to do.
Mm-hmm.
As an example, from paperback to the hardback, the colors are reversed.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't intend to do that, but it happened.
Oh, I thought that was intentional. It's kind of cool.
Good job, John.
Okay, where are we? Okay, I've lost my place. Okay.
John, I had a quick question.
Sure.
Yeah, so you've let's say you start with your Kindle version and you finish your Kindle version, all very nice. But then you're actually doing your paperback version and you know your real book on dead trees. And what do you do about the spacing between the spine and the margin of the text? Because often the text can be jammed into the spine of the book. It can be too close to the spine of the book. And so that margin has to be different than your Kindle version. Is that correct?
Oh, no, not necessarily. If you use a 1-inch margin all around,
uh-huh,
that will take care of it.
So a 1-inch left and right, top and bottom, then margin, and then you won't have that cramping into the spine of the actual book itself.
That's right.
Okay.
Word for those who want to have more space on the edges that are bound, Word provides a different layout for odd numbered pages and even numbered pages.
Ah.
So you can put a number, for example, on the upper right on the odd numbered page, and on the even number, you could put the upper left. Likewise, if you need more space in the middle for binding, you could specify a different margin on the binding side on the odd numbered and even numbered pages.
So in Microsoft Word, there's a way to do that.
It's called gutter.
A gutter.
You can just set the gutter whatever you want.
Okay. Okay.
Because the gutter is the part that gets bound. Okay. You can set a number for that if you want.
Okay.
You don't have to, but
yeah,
but you can.
Just, you know, that's very good to know. Good question.
Okay. Now the first step is to set up a KDP account in your name. If you already have an Amazon account, I think you may be able to use that. If not, go ahead and set up a new account with KDP. Now, after you've logged into your KDP account, you're ready to begin the process. You agree to the terms and conditions. You update your account information. The author publisher information is straightforward. And then you get to a part that says getting paid. And you select how you want to get paid. If you want to deposit it directly into your account.
What did you say?
Or send you a check.
Check a lot.
Check a lot.
And believe it or not, you have to put in tax information. So if you sell $1 million worth of books, you got a tax liability. But if you're like me, it's not really a problem. Okay, now you're ready to create, and you select paperback. Well, the next thing is the book title. You enter the title and any subtitles you may have. Language, of course, is English. And then there's series. If your book is a series, you need to link them together here. Mm-hmm. If this is not a series or this is the first book you've written, then leave it blank.
If you want me to pull up KDP for anybody to watch, to see it at any time, just let me know.
Okay. Now you get to the edition number. If you've updated or made additions to your original published book, then you should call this a second edition. Otherwise, leave it blank. As mentioned with the Violent Crown, there were so many mistakes in the first edition that I actually put second edition on the cover so that I could, you know, recognize it. Mm-hmm. Now, author, you're going to enter your name the way you wish it to appear on Amazon. Contributors, if anyone was a co-author, you include them here. Description. This is very important. You write a brief description or a plot summary of your book here. This will be used by Amazon to describe your book, so try to capture the reader's attention.
How long do you think that description should be?
Oh, I don't know. I use a plot summary on the back.
Mm-hmm.
Cover my books, and it's not really that long, but again, you try to grab their attention with it.
How long do they give you on the
I don't know, quite a bit.
They give you quite a bit?
Yeah.
I guess it would be good to like look at books that you like at the like the Amazon description to see how to
right.
Yeah.
John, yeah. I have another question. This is Carl. Right. My question is if you're using a nom de plume, will they allow you to actually put in a pen name and not your real name?
Yes, they will.
All right. So your pen name can be there, but of course, your real name is on all the credit info and bank accounts and things like that.
That's correct.
All right.
Is there another question over here? No.
I was just going to ask. Do they have a place for a log line? It's called a log line, which would be like a log line.
Log line?
Yeah, which is like a movie poster sentence, like.
Oh, okay.
No.
Yeah.
Just a very short.
Like sometimes they have
kind
like
a blurb.
I don't think so, no.
How about Great Mystery by John Murphy?
You can put that on the back cover of the book.
Actually, in my experience on Amazon with another book, and I did this long ago, but they'll allow you to upload connect blogs and connect videos and things like that to the book itself, which is a real nice feature. You could do a bio, and then you can have your videos and then extra information connected to the book digitally.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Did you use a nom de plume?
No, not on that one. I do academic publications, and it's just nice to have that reference. You know, it's a bio on the author and the book, and maybe the author actually reading portions of the book.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. After the description of the plot summary, you come to publishing rights. And you want to mark the box that shows you hold the copyright. Then you get to primary audience. This is where you indicate if your book contains sexually explicit language or not. Reading age is optional. But if you're writing for children or young adults, you indicate that here. Otherwise, leave it blank. Do not put in a writing age of 6 years to 99 years. That looks really strange. But if you're writing for young adults like Todd did, not that Todd's a young adult, but he would indicate the primary audience is young adults for his book. Now, the primary marketplace is going to be Amazon.com. Categories. You can choose up to three categories that are relevant to your book and genre, such as fiction, nonfiction, historical fiction, memoir, so on.
Do they provide the categories?
These are categories.
They give you the list of categories.
Yeah.
Yes. And then there are keywords. Now think of keywords, the words people might enter into the Amazon search bar looking for a book. It'll be such things as romance, mystery, thriller, suspense. These are the keywords that you should pick that describe your book. Publication date. If your book has not been published before, you select the first option.
What is the first option?
I don't know. Just select the first.
Okay. Oh, can I ask one other question about
sure.
For keywords? What if you're writing like commercial fiction, like literary fiction or upmarket commercial fiction, and it's not really one specific genre like romance or mystery?
If it's not one of the selections, you can type in your own.
Okay.
I think on the keywords, you can enter all you want.
Okay.
You make them up, as opposed to the one above the categories. Mm-hmm. It's a checklist, you know, it's a.
I see.
Multiple, but on the keywords, you can write your own keywords.
Okay.
Release date. check release my book for sale now. Now it's time to print the ISBN. You can get a free KDP ISBN. And to do that, you simply click assign me a free KDP ISBN. Now, this is very important. If you do not want to limit your distribution exclusively to Amazon, then you will want to buy your own ISBN and not use the free one from KDP.
So if you wanted your book on Ingram?
If you want to sell your book at Barnes & Noble, buy your own ISBN number.
How do you do that? You can Google it.
If you go online, you can buy them online. Buy it. Yeah.
They're not all that expensive.
You can buy a chunk of them.
You can buy a chunk. I paid $400 for 10, but I realize you can get them cheaper. If you shop around, you can get them cheaper.
Just on that note, you know, with Lulu, print on demand, they give you a free ISBN and you can sell that book on Amazon if you wish.
Well, I'm not familiar with Lulu.
Yeah, Lulu's been around forever. They do lots of graphic novels and printed books as well at Lulu, L-U-L-U. And they just offer you the free ISBN and you can sell that on any place you want. And so often I'll do the Lulu books sell those on Amazon.
So if you get the Amazon one, you can only sell it on Amazon?
Right. You're contractually obligated just to sell it on Amazon.
That's good to know.
Once you buy an ISBN, there has to be a collective bank of these ISBNs though, right?
Mm-hmm.
They're not just...
It's an international.
So it is an international, and there is a bank mm-hmm. that keeps track of all yeah. the ones that have been issued?
Yeah.
Okay.
But once you buy them, you don't have to use them.
Nope. Oh, well, hopefully I'll use them all up someday. But I own them.
Yeah. Okay.
So if you buy your own ISBN, then it still is available to be sold on Amazon as well?
Yes. Absolutely.
So you should buy it before you do all this?
If you don't want to use it, then you can enter.
Yeah. It's attached to a title when you buy it, or you
no, it? It's attached to you until you use it.
All good question.
Yeah. Point where you put it up on Amazon to the point where you get money in your bank account.
Years.
I don't know if that is ever guaranteed.
They give you any data on that, like the average time between publishing and getting your first dollar is 1 week, 1 month?
Well, it's a minimum 60 days.
60 days.
Okay. Minimum. Because they don't pay you for 30 days. They don't pay you for 30 days after they close the month. Okay. They take their own.
So if you sell something in the first month, you still won't get it until the 60th day.
Right. Oh. I sell rare books. Some of those books are listed on Amazon, and so I can sell my books that I print off of Lulu on Amazon.
Mm-hmm.
And on that market account, Amazon Seller Central account, they have a delay of 2 weeks for the payment once the books are purchased.
Did you know Johnny Jenkins?
No,
he was a rare book dealer in Austin.
Uh-huh.
Johnny Jenkins. Sounds like a character.
It sounds like the last book we read the author's name.
He died under very curious circumstances.
Oh, like the bookseller.
I see you on the front.
Yeah, that's another book. John Wright.
Somebody's already written that book.
Oh.
okay, I think we're at print options. This is where you select the ink and the type of paper. I use black and white interior with white paper. Now you select the trim size. Again, I use 6x9 inches. And you get to the bleed setting. And I use no bleed.
What is that?
Bleed really applies to any photographs or illustrations you may have in your book. If you select no bleed, that means the photograph or the illustration will adhere to the same margins as the written text. If you select bleed, that will allow you to have the photograph run to the edge of the page if you want.
So then whenever you cut it, whenever it's cut, it's kind of, mm-hmm. it's all, yeah. Like an infinity.
And I'm working on a book of my photography. So probably will.
John, I have another question. Does Amazon give you much of any in paper options and paperweights?
No, there are two paper options. One of them is white and the other one is kind of an off-white.
Okay, but they don't, as far as the thickness of the paper, they don't give you any option on paperweights.
No.
Okay. And on binding itself, there's just one type of binding. They don't give you binding options.
No, there's not That's any, it. Not any options really.
Okay. All right.
You'll need to know, you know, how many pages you have when you do the spine.
Yeah.
You need to know how many pages you Correct. Have, know how thick that spine is.
Yeah, so, and do you know that on that type of printing, what's the minimum amount of pages that you can have to actually, for it to bind well? 50, 100, 200?
24 is their minimum page number.
24 is the minimum. Okay. 24. Thank you.
Okay. Now we've done the trim size 6x9, the bleed settings, and then you get to the paperback cover, and I always use glossy. You have a choice between glossy and matte, and I think glossy looks better. I think double space is matte, mm-hmm. but pitchman is glossy. Mm-hmm. I think glossy looks better, but that's just a matter of opinion.
I have another question. Are they giving you a cover tool to make the cover, or do you upload the cover as a PDF?
We'll get to that in just a little bit.
Okay.
Now we're at the point where you upload your manuscript, and this is obviously a very important step. Now, before you do that, make sure your PDF manuscript is formatted correctly as indicated at the start of this document. And again, you need a minimum of 24 pages. KDP will tell you when the manuscript has been uploaded successfully. If it has not uploaded successfully, it will tell you what you need to correct. Now we get to the book cover. And this has been a fun part for me, but it can be complicated for the first-time user. KDP will let you create a unique cover design for your book for free. Now, you can also buy a professionally designed book cover if you like. On the first couple of novels or more than that, I design, you know, all these covers myself using KDP, thinking that buying a professionally designed cover would be too expensive. But when I got to my novel I'm working on now called Overkill, I actually bought a professionally designed cover. This cost $79.
Great.
And they only sell it once, so no one else can use it.
It looks really good.
So,
what website did you use?
I believe it's called Bespoke Book Covers.
There are different. You can if you.
There are a lot of them. And you know, we say we don't judge a book by its cover, but that's a lie.
Yeah, we do.
We all do it, consciously or subconsciously. We pick up the book that, you know, it's the most attractive. And you can select a photograph, which I did for Violet Crown. I used one photograph on the front, a different photograph on the back cover. I really thought the photograph for Double Space was made just for my book. It was perfect.
It is perfect. Yeah.
It's great.
And then on Pitchman, I have a photograph with a title superimposed on top of the photograph. Murder of Crows, I actually used a Well, I guess they have some graphics that you can select and colors. Anyway, I found one that looked like a tree, branches on a tree, so I chose that one.
Can I say also about that one that the graphic is really interesting, but also I really think the font you chose is really cool.
Yeah.
And I don't know how you chose the font, but I think that that works just as well and very well with the graphics.
And long story short, I just very simply, you know, wrote out the title. Again, on the back of all my books, I usually have the summary and then a brief bio with a photograph on the back. Also, on the last page of the book, I have a more complete bio. Okay, I think we're ready to design the book cover in KDP. It's called the cover creator, and there's generally three basic steps to creating a cover with KDP. One, you choose a design. Two is a style and edit. And three is preview. Now, after you choose the cover creator, you'll click on continue and you'll select an image from the image gallery. Now, all of the images are royalty-free photos. Now, Maureen gets upset every time I send her something with a photo on it because she's afraid I'm violating somebody's copyright. All of these are royalty-free images. And they're in several different kind of categories. So you can search through these images until you find the right one because it's really very important. You can also search by using a keyword such as mystery. Now, you're not required to use an image. You can use a solid color like I did on Long Story Short, or you use a pattern like I did on Murder of Crows. Now, if you're writing a memoir, you might want a family portrait on the cover. And that's fine. You can upload your own photographs.
That's a great idea. Like, even for a mystery, that's what someone else's.
Don't get the right
murder. Who's going to be my victim?
Now, if you do select an image for your cover, you can move the image around. You can resize it to fit on the cover the way you like. If you don't like what you see or you make a mistake, don't worry. You can always start over. I do that a lot. Then you're at a point where you choose the colors, the layout, and the fonts. When you choose the colors, you're going to select the colors of the cover, the back cover, the spine, and the color of the text, such as the title and the author's name and so on. When you choose a layout, you get to decide where the photo goes, where the title and author's name goes, and how the back cover looks, as well as the book's spine. And again, for my back cover, I always use a summary of the plot and a brief bio of the author with a small photo. When you choose fonts, you select the font you like best. Now, always remember on the back cover, you need to leave a space in the bottom right-hand corner, which is where the ISBN number will be printed automatically.
It it leaves that space for you.
It does.
Yeah, okay. It warns you.
I think it's interesting thinking about choosing fonts, right? Because you want something that's clear, because you don't want somebody to just not be able to read it when they read it quickly. But like that one, for instance, on A Murder of Crows, and Long Story Short, it's clear, but it's also like distinctive. Maybe you wouldn't want to have a ton written in that font, but like for a title, you know, it's great, I think. It's kind of distinctive.
So. Yeah.
Did you play around a lot, like visually selecting it? Okay.
And you notice there's a one font for the title, there's a different font for the author's name down at the bottom.
Mm-hmm. Make it distinctive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but if it's a smaller font, you want something really clear.
Yeah.
Right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay, we're in here. Fonts. Okay.
Does anybody else have questions while we're going along?
Now, if for any reason you're not finished and you need to leave KDP at any time, be sure to save as draft. If the phone rings and you don't know how long you're going to be on the phone, save your work as a draft. If you don't do this, you're going to lose everything.
So it's not just save, it's save as a draft.
Save as a draft.
As opposed to save and submit.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Are you speaking from experience?
Yeah. I am speaking from experience. You do not want to have to start over.
How safe to upload it?
I'm sorry?
You cut out a little.
How long does it take to do all of the, you know, formatting and choosing of covers and all that? Take a day or?
No.
Well, the first time around, and if you're designing your own cover, it can certainly take a day or even longer. Yeah.
But I guess it gets easier the more you do it, probably, too. So, but it's also part of the fun part, right? I mean, you can have fun.
I was thinking, yeah, you might want to save as a draft just so you can take your time.
Sleep on it and come back.
Right.
The next day. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You can come back days later and it'll be saved.
Yeah.
I might just go in and fill out a whole bunch of these for all the books that are in my head.
Well, I mean,
save as draft.
It is kind of fun to have a cover.
Yeah.
Even before you're done writing.
Yeah.
Because you're. I don't know. I think it's kind of inspiring.
Is it protected though? If you put it in there, I mean, someone else can't like grab it or something.
Or as I know, yeah. They can't. Nobody else can sign into your account.
Well, if it's saved as a draft, will it save it? How long will it save it?
I have no idea.
Yeah, I think indefinitely.
Yeah, on some other sites like Lulu that I use, you can save a draft. You can actually print that draft, and then you can actually, you know, mark it up and make the changes that you want. And some of these print on demands are so efficient that to upload a new version usually takes me about 10 to 15 minutes if I see spelling errors or anything like that. So it's really quickly, and then it's just the new version is ready to print right away.
It does seem like it would be nice before you submit it to be able to print it and see how it's going to look. Because sometimes you catch things that you didn't see when it was.
Yeah. Awesome. What I do is before I do the final draft, I do a version in which I have huge margins around the page, like 2 or 3 inch margins. Mm-hmm. And then I make notes. I print one copy. I send it to myself. And then I make notes in those margins about what I want to change. And then I go back and make those changes. Yeah. Always a good idea.
Okay. Now, once you get the cover design the way you want it, you're ready to save and submit. Now, it will tell you that the cover was uploaded successfully. If it's not successful, it'll tell you what the problem is. The most common problem is that the text does not fit in the space required. Mm-hmm. And it's simple to fix. You use a smaller font and make it fit.
What is a good size font to use or not use?
I use 12.
You mean on the cover?
I just mean anywhere. I guess I was thinking inside, but anywhere. I'm just curious because you don't want something that's going to be small and hard to read.
Yeah.
Definitely. Make font changes and size with deliberations. there is a ratio between the width of the line and the font. And if you violate that ratio, the text is harder to read.
Mm-hmm. What's the ratio?
It's secret.
12 for a 6.5-inch line, which is the normal paper. And that's one reason why people recommend 12 points, because so many first drafts are on typewriter size paper. However, different fonts have different sizes.
Yes.
And Times New Roman was designed to save on the cost of paper for the London Times newspaper. And they went overboard, and that's the reason we have Times New Roman, which was the revision.
Mm-hmm.
And it still saves paper,
mm-hmm.
but it's not necessarily the most readable.
Mm-hmm.
And there is one font designed specifically for typewriter sized paper, and that's Lucid Upright.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, it will cover more paper, but it was designed with the idea of being lucid for anyone who reads it. Word has this font. Other word processing software may or may not.
What's the name of the font?
Lucid.
Lucid Upright. It was designed with eye tracking studies.
Right.
So it's an empirical conclusion.
I'm curious about the size of the font in most of the novels in the stacks back there versus if you pick up a large print book,
mm-hmm.
and it is much easier to read, but like I'm not sure what the font size is in those two different ones.
Well, the ratios adjusted upward for people like me who begin to squint
like us, you mean.
All right. Thank you, John.
Okay. Now, after you have successfully uploaded your cover, there's a new question about AI-generated material. They recently added that, and just check no unless you've used AI to write any part of your book.
It's not AI for the cover, it's AI for text.
Yes.
Well,
what does that mean?
What does that mean? That is a good question. John, do you want to?
Well, if you've used any kind of artificial intelligence program to write any part of your book, you're going to have to acknowledge that here. If not, check no.
What do you mean by write?
AI will write it.
Well, I know that. So what I mean is you could, don't know a whole lot about this, but I've seen people take a paragraph of text that they wrote and then submit it on ChatGPT and say, write this in a more reading grade level 12. Rewrite this in a whole variety of other things where it starts with your text and does write the text. But so is that considered AI?
I'd say yes.
I'd say yes.
I'd say yes.
Mm-hmm.
It's up to you, though.
No, well, it is a.
I mean, I don't know if they'll catch you or not. How do you want to answer?
I was trying to get caught. I was just trying to figure out what they meant by AI.
Right. So if you have AI write any draft, if it's AI assisted, then yes.
So the answer to that question is.
AI is going to be any better than you, because I'm in a job right now that I'm contracting for a vendor and I'm teaching AI how to write. So, you know, you never know who you're getting.
That sounds interesting, Lauren.
It's not. It may be. I just don't.
There are debates among English teachers, and many of them think that AI is useful for suggesting approaches.
Mm-hmm.
Also, you have to be aware of, say, a Vietnamese student who wants to be an auto mechanic, and AI can save him a lot of trouble. The idea of AI as a suggestion for approaches
mm-hmm.
is pretty much accepted among English teachers, according to what I hear.
Mm-hmm.
What's your take on it as an English teacher?
I haven't been in the classroom for a while, so I think I would find it pretty intimidating right now.
Yes.
Well, I recently read someone who used a prompt for an essay and then had added instructions in white print on a white background. The computer could read it, but the student could not.
Mm-hmm.
And that white on white prompt said to insert two words. And she used that to see who was overly dependent upon AI.
Oh,
which I thought is more high tech than I ever imagined.
There's a YouTube channel. I know about this much about AI, mm-hmm. but not YouTube, right? But there's a YouTube channel called The Nerdy Novelist. As don't say hundreds of probably exaggeration, 30 or 40 to episodes specifically and only about using AI to write.
Oh, wow. Well, it depends on your purpose.
Right.
If you are in a job and not a literary person, then it's a time saver.
Yeah. He's talking about using to write novels.
Well, let's see.
Then we hit launch. Is that next?
Yeah, let's keep going. And I mean, this is a really interesting discussion about AI, and we could spend the whole evening talking about it. Yeah. So,
okay, we're at a point for the book preview, launch preview. This is a very important step. This is your last chance to correct spelling and format. You want to go through this page by page to make sure everything is the way you want it before you save it in final form.
Show you exactly the way it's going to
show
up.
Absolutely. The whole book will be shown there and you can flip pages. And it's, some people might want to flip through kind of fast, but don't do it. Yeah. It takes a while, but go through it page by page. Make sure everything is okay.
Mm-hmm.
One of my glitches.
Now you get to the paperback rights and the pricing. Territories, you'll select all territories, simply means you want it for sale everywhere. The primary marketplace is going to be Amazon.com. And you get to the pricing, royalty, and distribution. The marketplace lists every country where your book will be available. The list price is the US dollar price. And that'll be the first country you see is the U.S. and its dollar price.
Mm-hmm.
And you get to Amazon rate and royalty. There are two, these two columns show the royalty rate and the amount you can expect to make from each sale. Amazon calculates the royalty by multiplying the royalty rate by the list price less the printing cost. As an example, my novel, A Murder of Crows, retails for $9.99. The print cost is $3.11. So I earn $2.88 per book. That's 60% times $9.99 less the cost of printing equals $2.88 per book.
How did you decide to charge $9.99?
Just out of the top of my head.
Okay. And what's the 60%?
That's the royalty rate.
Okay. What is the royalty rate?
That's what Amazon gets.
60%? 60?
Yeah.
1.6. Minus the printing cost.
Less the printing cost.
Mm-hmm. Amazon gets 60 and you get 40 minus the printing cost? You get 60.
Something like that.
And they get 40. Amazon gets 40.
Yes.
Okay.
And the printing cost.
Okay. Terms and conditions. Now, when you click publish your paperback book, it's not you are, it should be your.
That's all right.
You're bound by Amazon's terms and conditions. Your book will be available on Amazon within 72 hours, and Amazon will send you an email when the book goes live.
Right.
Now, you have a choice of requesting a book proof, but keep in mind that book proofs are not the same as copies bought from Amazon. The proofs are of inferior quality, and they have not for sale stamped across the front and the back covers. Mm-hmm. As the name implies, they're used as proof copies for you to make sure there is nothing you need to change. I don't like to get book proofs. What I like to get are author copies. When your book goes live, you can go to your KDP dashboard and you can locate your book. Click on the ellipses beside paperback actions and click on order author's copies. Now, author copies are exact copies of what is sold on Amazon, and they do not have not for resale printed across the cover. So I prefer to get those. Now, you can order up to 999 author copies for just the printing cost. So you're going to be paying like $3 a book.
Plus the shipping.
If you have not requested a book proof, I recommend that you order one author copy and check it for accuracy. If everything looks good, you can then order up to 998 more author copies for the cost of printing.
But is your book available for sale in the meantime, like someone could order it? If you caught a flaw, you want to correct it, you've already...
I was wondering that for...
But you can still make corrections even after it's been published.
Okay. I was wondering, so if you get a proof, what is the... Why would you want to get a proof instead of an author copy?
Well, you can get the proof before the book goes for sale.
Right.
Okay, so you could.
But you can't get the author copies until after it goes for sale.
Right.
Okay, so if you want to have a proof so that you can kind of go through again and really see.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay.
So it delays the book going live.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, a little bit.
Okay.
So, I'd like to challenge you to publish your first book. Collect your essays into a single manuscript, create a title page, a dedication, copyright statement, table of contents. At the end, add an author's bio with a photograph. Keep in mind, you'll need a minimum of 24 pages. Now, format the manuscript as indicated above at the beginning of this document. Convert the manuscript into a PDF document. Use a trim size of 6x9 inches, and you're now ready to enter KDP and publish your book. Congratulations, you're now a published author. Wouldn't it be great if every member of the West End Writers Group was a published author?
Yeah. Yes, that's a good goal.
I published, long story short, a collection of essays. It's got 27 essays, 80 pages long. You can use this as a guide for formatting your book if you like. And you can contact me if you have any questions.
That's it.
So well done, Johnny.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You made it.
Excellent.
Thank you so much for all of this information.
Sorry for all the...
Go for it. Lauren, if you have questions or comments, please go ahead.
I just want to write a book, and I'm going to take that invitation up.
Great. I look forward to it.
So well. Yeah. I think that a lot of us, writing the book is one hurdle. Publishing it, if we're considering self-publishing, figuring out how to do that is another big hurdle. And this takes that hurdle and makes it much simpler, I think, because it
really does.
It kind of takes some of the mystery out of it. These are the steps. Follow these steps.
Yeah.
So,
I particularly want to thank you for the step-by-step.
Yeah.
So well done.
Definitely looks smaller than the book KDP has.
Right. Yeah. You don't really need all this.
John, why have you decided to not do ebooks?
I did it on the first one. I don't know. I just don't see anybody buying an ebook.
They don't sell as much. I've sold some. I've sold maybe a half dozen ebooks, and
I thought the majority of Amazon books.
That's what I thought too. I don't sell as many. I sell more hard paperbacks than
I do. You think it has some to do with the genre?
I have no idea, but since my books are illustrated, mm-hmm. maybe that has something to do with it.
I think that if you were writing,
or the genre,
if you're writing romance, I think that romance sells pretty well on ebooks because then anybody can get whatever they want without having somebody.
See
while they're riding the bus what they're reading. You're just reading on your Kindle. Yeah. You can tell what you're reading, right?
I might add Ingram Spark is very similar. It's free and it's very similar. And then it's available to libraries and bookstores worldwide. Mm-hmm. The paper, Ingram Spark. Ingram Spark Publishing.
It's a publishing.
They're like the world's largest wholesaler of books. And the basic book is very similar to Amazon. It's almost identical. What's harder is the cover because they have a cover tool, but it's not nearly as easy as Amazon's cover tool. So you have to put more work into the cover. And
if you buy your ISBN number, you can do both.
Oh, yeah.
I was wondering how much it costs to publish and write a book on eBay. I mean, not eBay, on Amazon.
It's free. It's absolutely free. It costs nothing.
Yeah, I thought I'd mention that because I've worked with Lulu all these years, I do a lot of specialty publications, and it's insane how much it costs to actually print the book. So here's just one of the books that I do. I'll just show it really quickly here. If you can see that, hold on. These are rubbings by Joan Patton. These are ancient Maya rubbings. And I make this on InDesign. Let me see if I can get that there a little bit. And it's about 60 pages. And the reason I was asking about paperweight and things like that, because these are for like, this is archival work for libraries and things of that nature. It's just quite remarkable. I've done books for friends, books on ancient Latin poetry. This is another book here. It's a Maya 2012. This is a day calendar that has the Gregorian and Maya Maya dates on them, mm-hmm. and things of this nature. So Amazon will you can make this off site on another book generator and actually sell it on Amazon. I totally herald and encourage everybody. If you have a little book in your head, these print on demand like Lulu, you can print a very high quality book it's amazing how cheaply that they can print it and bind it. Mm-hmm.
Good to know.
The more people see it on Amazon.
Well, he's making it on Lulu, but are you selling them on Amazon?
That's right. So I make them on Lulu, and therefore Amazon doesn't get the cut of the book. I sell it on Amazon as an independent bookseller through their Seller Central account, and you can make a Seller Central account for free and sell any books that you want. You're limited maybe to 40 books or something like that per week. So you can do it that way. So basically it's up on Amazon. Somebody orders it. I print it on Amazon. I mean, I print it on Lulu and I send it directly the book directly to them from Lulu, or I have printed copies that I send out myself once the order is made.
How much of a cut does Lulu's get?
Lulu just is, it's just the cost of the printing.
So is it expensive or something?
Yeah, so they don't ask for a cut of the actual book. I guess they would if you sold it on them, but I don't sell the books on Lulu. I sell them on Amazon since they're kind of like the main platform to sell books on.
Are you saving money by creating it on Lulu then?
Yeah, I do. I buy them. I create them. I buy them in bulk. Like I'll buy 25 to 50 copies. I'll print. And I'll send those copies to myself. And then as people request it on Amazon, I'll send those copies out to them. Correct. But Amazon will take a cut on the shipping, of course. Mm-hmm. That's how they make their money.
You don't $4. Pay. Amazon handles the shipping.
Yeah. No. You handle the shipping, but Amazon will take a cut of that shipping. That's how they make their dollar.
Okay.
Yeah.
How much do you profit?
Well, like the Rubbings book sells for $25. And off of that, I make about, I'd make about $12 off of a $25 when after all said and done with all the shipping and all the other costs involved.
The books have been sold.
Yeah. This book has gone all over the world and it's in all the major libraries and archives, Mesoamerican archives in the United States. So Tulane, Chicago, New York, UCLA. Yeah, it's a real kind of a specialty one. But this was just to cement Joan's legacy, who actually created the rubbing. So I did it as a favor to her.
Right.
Well, I want to tell John, thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, John. Yeah.
And more questions may come up as different.
I have lots of questions, but I'll hold them for another time.
Yeah. I know you do. But, you know, as more of us are getting ready to publish in various ways, different ideas will come up and different questions will come up. So this is great, though. This is really helpful, very valuable information. Next Monday, we will be online and we will discuss. I know, Louise, you and I can discuss if next Monday is good for you or if another Monday is better for you.
Okay.
We'll email about that.
I'll let you know.
Okay, no problem. And so, anyway, I'm excited about the eclipse next Monday. You guys have need information.
Right. We'll meet that same night.
We're going to meet that evening, but we're going to be online, so you don't have to try
if
to.
We're not blind.
Don't
blind ourselves. To be online.
Yeah. How soon should we think about what is best to meet in person for June, July, and August? And is September back to Monday in person?
As far as I know, that this is no. I think that
they said summer.
Well, so the people who are online, let me just say that we're going to keep meeting online on Mondays. Nothing's changing there. How normally right now we have an in-person option, one Monday a month, right, like this. But however, this room that we're in is going to be occupied starting in like mid-May by a program that's going to be for kids and families. And so what I would like to do is continue having our program be online on Monday evenings because we have a good thing going here. We've got a good rhythm. And then if we want to offer an in-person option once a month, we would pick a different day. So it would actually be an additional meeting once a month. We were talking about Thursday evening once a month. So I'm interested to know your thoughts. Feel free to send me an email if you have thoughts about that, and we will discuss.
In addition,
it's an additional meeting. So we're not taking away any meetings. It's just our in-person option would be on a different day each month. So possibly Thursday evenings if that seems like it would be good. So, and it might be a slightly different format. We might be more like a social, like people could bring excerpts of pieces to read. We could talk about projects we're working on and not so much like a class, but more like kind of a way to get to know each other and each other's writing. So anyway. mull it over, discuss amongst yourselves. And when I see you online next Monday, we can discuss that more. So, okay.
Natural alert because of a big storm that's happening. So think of us when you're.
Yes,
they're getting that weather.
You're getting the weather that we're going to get later tonight. Lisa, good luck.
Yeah, we're getting it.
Stay safe.
Do we have tornadoes forecasted or?
Yes.
We have hail.
Large hail coming.
Ah, okay. I'll have to look. Thank you.
Yeah, get somewhere safe. Okay.
You guys stay safe, have fun, enjoy the eclipse. If you need eclipse information, let me know. The library will have eclipse classes, two pairs per family starting tomorrow.
Oh, great. I'll pick some up. Great. Thank you.
We'll see you guys later. Take care.
All right. Thank you, everybody.
Bye.
Thank you, John.
Thank you, John. Yes.
I feel
enlightened.
More prepared.